This is a Clark University podcast.
Any technical hiccup can like really pull you out of a story. So it's very important that the mood of each scene and the characters is honed in to really heighten the story arc that the director originally intended. With sound and color, costume, lighting, all that stuff, you can really finesse their vision in that regard.
When Clarkie Brian Woos landed an internship at a film company in New York, he stumbled into a room and found himself fascinated by the panel in front of him.
I just saw like this like big panel, and the panel has a bunch of buttons, but for the most part, it has three wheels on it. I just looked in a room and saw somebody in the zone just grading something, and that just completely blew me away.
The site introduced Brian to what his future career as a colorist would look like. Brian graduated from Clark in 2016 with a degree in screen studies and music. Now he's a colorist at PostWorks in New York and spends his days finessing brightness, saturation, and texture on indie films and major pictures alike.
Being a colorist, it's like you're kind of working on many projects at once at different stages. A colorist would most likely be involved at the very beginning. So for like hair and makeup design, location, you are basically, they're going to do test shoots, which is called a hair and makeup test, where you can have main cast or even just crew members dressing up in the costumes. They would shoot it, send you the media, and you would start messing with the colors, the brightness and the saturation. And nowadays texture is like a big thing because people, they like to add grain and diffuse like highlights subtly so it looks a little bit more period. So you go through that process with the cinematographer and the DIT and the director, and you kind of nail down like, oh, this is in general how we want this film to look. So a lot of the times, even when something's like super moody, it actually wasn't that moody on set, but it's just lit that way so that you kind of have that opportunity. That's what I call like broad stroke color grading. That's like, we are going to completely shift this world to be romantic or completely shift this world to be absolutely horrifying. When you're in the editing phase, which can last anywhere between 6 months and 2 years, the editors are working with something that actually like matches and feels like it's in the same world. And there's no like cuts between characters where it's like, oh, that's jarring. This is distracting because this doesn't match or the colors aren't right. And then once that process is done, you go through the conform process. So basically the editors and the directors have their cut locked and then they send us their project. And then that's when the colorist is really sitting down for typically like a month of grading a movie or a TV show and really finessing the world. The final finishing process is kind of where the chaos and the heavy lifting occurs because there's a lot of communications between the visual effects teams, which is mostly multiple VFX houses, and we basically color the movie to both theatrical release and streaming and HDR.
I'm Melissa Hansen, a producer in Clark's communications office, and this is Challenge Change. Brian enjoys the challenge of finishing films on incredibly tight deadlines as much as taking on long-term projects that occupy his attention for weeks or months. While working on Uncut Gems, the 2019 thriller featuring Adam Sandler, Brian ensured the colors were bright and bold on screen.
That one was actually shot on film, which excites a lot of people, honestly, because when you shoot on film, like you automatically get this texture quality and like there's subtle weaving, and it's just the image is way more alive than a digital image. So whenever somebody shoots film, it's just very exciting. That film is very chaotic. Their whole thing was make the blues really pop and make it very neon-y and noir in a way with those colors. You have so many people in the room. Producers are there, cinematographers are there, editors, assistant editors, all kind of looking at this image and making sure that we're not going out of bounds and we're keeping it in the world that the Safdie brothers want. You know, that process was probably like, I'm gonna guess that was like a 3 month process in terms of like visual effects, color, and delivering to theaters.
I made a crazy risk, a gamble. And it's about to pay off. So I want the Celtics to cover. I want the Celtics halftime. I want Garnett points and rebounds.
What do you know?
I don't know, I just know.
What's the dumbest bet I ever heard of?
I disagree.
I disagree, Gary.
Colorists like Brian see many versions of a film before it's ready for the public eye. It's one of the most thrilling parts of the job.
The colorist or even anybody involved in post-production will see many, many versions of the film before it's actually delivered to wide releases, so to speak. You go to a film festival and it usually gets acquired and you maybe make additional changes before it then goes out for mass release. That's the first time the director is actually able to sit with an audience and like get their reaction too, which is very interesting. They might even come back and be like, hey, like we're delivering to so-and-so. And I realized that when watching this with an audience that we should actually probably take this scene out and cut this one back in. And I think it would, you know, do X, Y, and Z. That's honestly one of the most underrated parts of the job is just being able to like see the creative changes and why. Because when you work on a movie or TV show, you've seen like 30 different versions of it before it actually comes out. Alternate endings, beginnings, middle, ends, all that stuff. So it's pretty cool. What I just love about it is just seeing the reaction of people. It's like, wow, like we've been working on this for so long and it's about to be delivered. The colorist is literally at that delivery stage because the colorist has all the final visual effects, has all the titles, has the final sound, and you're literally watching it through a projector the way people are going to be seeing in a theater and like color grading it real time. I would say it's more fascinating to look at it from their perspective and seeing how excited and anxious they are. To just be involved in something for that long and it's about to now be seen by thousands or millions of people, that's pretty fascinating to see.
Growing up, Brian found himself drawn to films that used simple techniques to tell complex stories.
It's pretty cliche, but I just remember like putting on Shawshank Redemption when I was like in eighth grade. I have never seen a movie that had that ending. Crazy thing is I never really watched TV. I watched movies, I never watched TV, and it's actually starting to turn a little bit. Now I'm starting to watch TV more than movies. I would say one of the biggest influential directors while I was growing up was probably Darren Aronofsky. He's the guy who did like Pi and The Wrestler and Black Swan. The Wrestler, I would say, is probably my favorite movie of his. He actually shot it almost like a documentary. Like the whole movie is pretty much him like behind this beat up wrestler, just kind of going through his life. And it's like a super huge, dramatic indie film. You just realize how simple things can be. And you don't really need to like overthink it, so to speak, or you don't need to have like deep pockets to like make, you know, a meaningful film.
Brian started his career with essential knowledge about the intricacies of different lenses, lessons he picked up during a cross-country road trip with now-retired professor Frank Armstrong.
He started in Massachusetts, actually picked me up in my hometown in Cleveland. We drove all the way from Cleveland to Alaska, driving only side roads, unless we absolutely had to get on the highway. And the purpose was to just take photographs of abandoned, unseen communities that were once flourishing. When you're doing color, it's not just brightness, luminance, saturation, hue shift. Like you can like warp an image to like give it a fisheye look or give it old lens looks. Just the way he was just so open about me just asking him super nerdy technical questions, I would say that stuff really helped me apply certain things in the color room. And also just like speaking the language.
Brian's favorite photos from that trip were shot in South Dakota.
the vastness and like the stillness and just how flat everything was. That I remember struck me big time, for sure. You kind of have no choice but to kind of look within yourself when you're in that environment.
To learn more about screen studies at Clark, visit clarku.edu/screen-studies. Challenge Change is produced by Andrew Hart and Melissa Hansen for Clark University. Find other episodes wherever you listen to podcasts.
One, two, three.
Clark!